Whap! The sound of the rock hitting the windshield startled me so much. Have you ever been hit with a stone in your windshield? We used to live near two rock quarries, and it probably was once a year that I'd be following a truck from the rock quarry, and a rock would launch off of the truck like a missile and smack into my windshield. Often it landed right in front of the driver's side, right where you would need to see, and it would obscure my vision. And then from that initial crack, a spider web of cracks would branch out across the glass. Each day, the cracks would grow, snaking across the windshield. People are like that windshield. They have been hit by flying stones. Sometimes it's just a stone or two, maybe one chip, maybe two, but sometimes it's years worth of stones chipping away at them. Suddenly, spider-like webs begin to stretch across their glass. Cracks grow and spread until it is hard for us who are on the outside to see who it is on the inside. And the person on the inside has a hard time seeing out. Today, I want to tell you the story of two women who have been dinged by a series of stones chipping away at their lives like glass on a windshield. The first woman is never named, and the second woman is named Jenna. Let's talk about the first woman. It was early in the morning, and Jesus was teaching again in the temple. He was teaching a large crowd. John says it was all the people. Suddenly, there was a commotion and noise as the scribes and Pharisees pushed through the crowd. They were dragging a woman who they said had been caught in the act of adultery. I've always wondered why they weren't dragging the man in with her. They made her stand before the crowd, before the scribes, before the Pharisees, before her peers, before Jesus. Was she weeping? Was her hair a mess? Was her clothing dirty and torn and disheveled from having been dragged through the streets? And what was it like to be exposed in front of all of those people? Teacher, they said to Jesus, teacher, this woman has been caught in the very act of adultery, and Moses' law commands us to stone a woman like her. So Jesus, what do you say? They said this to test him so that they would have some charge to bring against him. And Jesus is quiet. He just bends down and writes with his finger in the dirt. Pay attention to the next verse. They kept on questioning him. The scribes and the Pharisees were relentless as they hounded Jesus, trying to catch him violating the law. So what's it going to be, Jesus? Keep the law and stone the woman? Or don't stone her and look weak and ineffectual in the eyes of the law? Oh, friends, it's so easy to throw rocks at other people. That's what the Pharisees and the scribes were doing, and they didn't care who got hurt. I'm afraid that's what we do too often as well. And social media has only made it that much easier to throw stones. There's so much more I wish we knew about this story and this woman. Did she truly and willingly engage in the act of adultery? Or was she taken advantage of by some man who had power over her emotionally or physically? And if she did willingly commit adultery, what led her to do that? What unmet need did she have in her life that caused her to seek affection and attention from a married man? What trauma had she experienced in her life? It's so easy to stand in judgment in front of other people and throw stones at them when truly we have no idea what someone else has experienced. The woman in this story reminds me of Jenna, the main character in the musical Waitress. Waitress was on Broadway, and it has music and lyrics by the incomparable Sarah Bareilles. It's based on a 2007 play by the same name and a movie written by Adrian Shelley. Here's the story. Waitress is set in a small southern town, and it tells the story of Jenna Hunterson. Jenna is a waitress and an expert pie baker at Joe's Diner. Jenna imagines that everything in her life, every situation, is a kind of pie. Pie is her language in which she is fluent. And as a little girl, making pies with her mother is one of the few memories of love that she carries with her. Jenna is trapped in an abusive marriage. Her husband, Earl, controls every facet of her life, who she sees, where she goes, how long she can be gone. He steals the tips she earns at the diner and threatens to make her give up her dream of entering a pie-baking contest. See, Jenna had hoped that if she entered that pie-baking contest, she could take the prize money and escape her abusive marriage. Now, Jenna finds herself pregnant and afraid. Jenna, who after a lifetime of abuse is looking for kindness, finds it in the arms of another man. His name is Dr. Pometer, and he's the new OBGYN at her clinic. Of course, in real life, it is unethical, and any physician who had an affair with a patient would be brought up on charges, but this is theater. In the musical, Dr. Pometer and Jenna both feel undervalued. With one another, they begin to discover that they do indeed have some worth and value. Stay tuned for how their situation will resolve itself. Sarah Bareilles writes these lyrics. She's imperfect, but she tries. She is good, but she lies. She is hard on herself. She is broken. She won't ask for help. She is messy and she's kind. She's lonely most of the time. She is all of this mixed up and baked in a beautiful pie. Listen as Rachel Bridges sings "She Used to Be Mine" by Sarah Bareilles.
It's not simple to say. Most days I don't recognize me, that these shoes and this apron, that place and its patrons have taken more than I gave them. It's not easy to know I'm not anything like I used to be, although it's true I was never attention's sweet center. I still remember that girl. She's imperfect, but she tries. She is good, but she lies. She is hard on herself. She is broken and won't ask for help. She is messy, but she's kind. She is lonely most of the time. She's all of this mixed up and baked in a beautiful pie. She is gone, but she used to be mine. And it's not what I asked for. Sometimes life just comes in through a back door and carves out a person and makes you believe it's all true. And now I've got you. And you're not what I asked for. If I'm honest, I know I would give it all back for a chance to start over, to rewrite an ending or two. For the girl that I knew who'd be reckless just enough, who'd get toughen up when she's bruised and gets used by a man who can't love. And then she'll get stuck and get scared by the life that's inside her, growing stronger each day. She is gone, but she used to be mine.
The woman stands before Jesus, and the crowd is waiting, stones at the ready to go after her. Maybe she, like Jenna, has already endured a lifetime of being hit by stones. Perhaps, like Jenna, they were stones of physical or emotional abuse. Maybe the stones have left her without resources to survive. Maybe they've left her without options. Maybe the stones have left her so pockmarked by shame she can hardly see herself. Stones heaped upon her by others and stones she lobbed at herself. She is like that cracked, spidery windshield. She's not able to see out, and others are not able to see in and see who she really is. Too often, women, especially young women, have been socialized to believe that their worth comes through their sexuality, through their ability to have a man find them attractive. And too often women have confused physical intimacy with emotional intimacy. Maybe this was her story. Jesus had been teaching all the people, John says. He'd been painting a compelling picture of the kingdom of God, a kingdom where grace and love abound, a kingdom that's big enough for everyone. Big enough for people who have had rocks lobbed at them all their lives, and big enough for people who have thrown the rocks too. People like Jenna, people like this woman, people like you and me. Now, the penalty for adultery was stoning. So what would happen? Jesus, he bent down and wrote with his finger in that sandy desert ground. What do you suppose he wrote? Don't you wish we knew? Was he just drawing in the sand to stall for some time while he thought of what to do? Or maybe he was writing names down. Maybe he was writing names of those present. Did he write the woman's name? Maybe he wrote the man's name. Did he write the names of the people in the crowd? The names of the scribes and the Pharisees? Could they all see their names written there in the sand? When they kept questioning him, Jesus straightened up and he said to them, "Let anyone among you who is without sin be the first to throw a stone." I wonder if Jesus didn't say that because he knows that when we throw stones at others, we wind up wounding ourselves as well. See, too often we who claim to be followers of Jesus throw stones. We can lob scripture stones at people like hand grenades. We live in a nation of rock throwers, people on the right, people on the left, throwing stones because it sure is easier to throw a stone than to work for solutions. Right now, people are throwing critical race theory around like it's a boulder in an attempt to deny racism. But rocks hurt, don't they? It's always fun to throw rocks until someone gets hurt. Once again, Jesus bends down and he wrote on the ground. Let the one who is without sin throw the first stone, he says. And then he waits. And he doesn't say anything. And slowly, one by one, they begin to walk away. After the crowd and the Pharisees and the scribes all left, who was left behind? Just Jesus and this woman. And Jesus does not pick up a stone. Woman, he says to her, where are they? Has no one condemned you? And she says, no one, sir. And Jesus says to her, neither do I condemn you. And from now on, go and do not sin again. She is given the opportunity to begin again through the grace of Jesus Christ. One of the things I love most about the Gospels is the same thing I love about musical theater. People are presented with all of their flaws and their failings, their doubts and their struggles. Dr. Pometer, Jenna, the waitresses, Earl, we see ourselves in them. The crowd, the Pharisees, the scribes, the woman brought before Jesus, we see ourselves in them too. Back to Jenna, our waitress. The diner, Al's Diner, was owned by a crusty old man named Joe. And Joe owned several businesses, and he would come every day and sit in Jenna's section of the diner. And he always had a long list of demands: water, no ice, salad, dressing on the side, meat, no spice. But always, always, he wanted a piece of Jenna's pies. Joe said that Jenna's strawberry oasis pie could solve all the problems in the world. Jenna and old Joe, they become friends as he listens to her and gives her advice. And for the first time in her life, she meets someone who doesn't want anything from her. He just wants something for her. Jenna goes into labor, and coming into the hospital, she sees old Joe. Old Joe is going in to have surgery, and what Joe knows but Jenna does not is that he is dying. And he gives her an envelope and says, open it later, Jenna. The pain of the contractions hit her, and she forgets about the envelope for a while. She gives birth to a beautiful baby girl named Lulu. And she who has summoned up this terrific strength to give birth summons up that same strength to tell her abusive husband that she wants a divorce. And she tells Dr. Pometer their relationship is over. Jenna decides to make a change for her sake and for her daughter. The next day on the bedside table in her hospital room, she sees that envelope from old Joe. When she opens it, she discovers that he has left the diner to her. All he asks is that she would name a pie after him. So she thinks about her brand new baby, and she sings these words. I didn't know, but now I see. Sometimes what is meant to be. You saved me. My blurry lines, my messy life, they come into focus, and in time, maybe I can heal and I can breathe, because I can feel myself believe. Everything changes. Oh, my heart's at the wheel now, and all my mistakes, they make sense when I turn them around. Everything changes. What I thought was so permanent, in the blink of an eye, there's a new life in front of my face. So I swear I'll remember to say we were both born today. Because everything changed. Everything changes. I'll remember to say we were both born today. Born again. That is grace. Grace for the woman caught in adultery. Grace for Jenna, who has discovered her worth. Grace for us all. I will leave you in just a moment with a duet sung by Rachel and David Berger called You Matter to Me. What I want you to remember today is that when you feel chipped up like a spidery, broken windshield, remember that God's grace is with you. God's grace is for you. And you matter. You really do. Amen.
I can find the whole meaning of life in those sad eyes. They've seen things that you never quite say, but I hear. Come out of hiding, I'm right here beside you. And I'll stay there as long as you let me. Because you matter to me. Simple and plain, and not much to ask from somebody. You matter to me. I promise you do. You matter to me. I promise you do.
Yourself think the things that I say just might matter to someone. All of this time I've been spending my mind on the running away, and for the first time I think I'll consider the stay. Because you matter. Simple and plain, and not much to ask from somebody. You matter to me. I promise you do. You matter to. I promise you do.
You matter to me.